Thank you so much. Good morning, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 2022 SVRI Grants Award Ceremony. Thank you for joining us today as we announce and celebrate the new cohort of grantees from different regions of the world who won the 2022 SVRI Research Grant Knowledge for Action to End Violence Against Women and Violence Against Children. The SVRI Award is a highly competitive and coveted award in the research field, aimed at supporting research on violence against women and violence against children in low and middle income countries. We want to financially support research in low income settings where resources are so scarce and where there is so much need for evidence-based interventions. But we also promote the colonial forms of knowledge, ethical funding, and a feminist approach and ethos to research. You will hear more about this from our AD later on in the webinar. Now, some few home housekeeping matters. Next slide, please. Thank you. So this session is being recorded and will be available in the SVRI website. Participants are muted. There is worldly translation available, and you have to go to the bottom of your screen where you will see an icon like a globe, and you can choose the language that you want to get translation from. Remember, it's not an interpretation, it's a translation service. And now, also we encourage you to introduce yourself in the chat and put questions in the Q&A session. Our panel of speakers today include Professor Rachel Dukes from the South African Medical Research Council, our ED Liz Darnall, a current grantee from the SVRI from Nepal, Anil Raghuvanshi, and of course, our new cohort of grantees who shall remain incognito until the end of the event. But the question many of you might have, first of all, is how are the new grantees going to contribute to building evidence in the field? What do we know already about what works or does not work? What are the research gaps? To address these questions and more, we are now joined by our keynote speaker, Professor Rachel Dukes. Professor Dukes is a founding member of the Sexual Violence Research Initiative and a member of our Leadership Council. She is the Executive Scientist for Research Strategy in the Office of the South African Medical Research Council. She is an A1 rated scientist. She was formerly Director of the South African Medical Research Council's Gender and Health Research Unit and is an honorary professor at the School of Public Health at the University of the Witwatersrand in Johannesburg. She has led research in South Africa and globally on the intersection of gender inequity, gender-based violence, and health. She is the author of over 300 peer-reviewed journal articles, reports, training manuals, and book chapters. We are honored to have Rachel with us today to welcome our new cohort. Over to you, Rachel.
Thank you very much, Angelica. And good afternoon, good morning to everybody. I'm delighted to be able to do this. I think the work of the SVRI in funding research within the field is small, but plays an incredibly vital role. And so I'm very pleased to be able to contribute to this today by talking to you a bit and setting the scene. If I can have my first slide. So just to understand how critical this is, over the last year, the SVRI has been looking at investment into research funding within the field and has shown that whilst the global cost of violence against women is estimated at about $1.5 trillion, which is about 2% of global GDP, or roughly the size of the whole economy of Canada. In fact, the overseas development assistance that is directed at violence against women programming is a pitiful 0.9%. And of this amount of money, less than 0.1% goes to research. And in fact, we're not able in this figure to look at the proportion of that amount that ends up in research in low and middle income countries. But obviously, it's a very much smaller proportion. One of the key initiatives, it's next slide, in the field to try and build research knowledge on what works to prevent violence against women and girls and build networks, support capacity development amongst researchers in low and middle income countries was the DFID funded What Works to Prevent Violence Against Women and Girls global program. The overall program had three components, and it was looking at the prevalence and drivers of violence, what works in prevention, and the costs of violence prevention and the costs of inaction. And the work was conducted in 15 countries of Africa and Asia and the Middle East. And we conducted 5 prevalence studies, 3 studies looking at the cost to business, and 6 studies that were looking at the costs of prevention and essentially the costs of inaction. And I was fortunate to lead the global program, which was the biggest of these pieces. If we can have the next slide. Through that work, we were working in 13 countries, and we were doing research essentially around 4 different types of prevention programming. One was community activism approaches to shift harmful gender norms, roles and attitudes. We were also looking at gender transformative interventions that had an economic empowerment component as their pathway towards preventing violence against women and girls. We evaluated several interventions looking at violence among and against children, and interventions that took couples approaches or worked with special populations. On the next slide, I think one of the most important areas of conclusions that we reached through this work were essentially evidence on drivers of violence that enabled us to come up with a new summary of drivers of violence. And this is presented in this slide. And I hope that you will agree that this approach is particularly informative for the development and testing of interventions to prevent violence. So essentially, we squarely position the role of the structural drivers, gender inequality, normative use of violence in social relations, and poverty, which is inseparably linked to these, and all of the other ramifications of poverty, including poor education. These impact risk of exposure to child abuse, but and neglect, with a very important emphasis on the word and there, because it is the neglect of boy children, which is so critical in terms of perpetration of violence against women and girls, much as we know that sexual abuse exposure makes boys much more likely to become perpetrators of sexual violence. But we must emphasize neglect here. We know that one of the key impacts of that is poor communication within relationships and extenuated relationship conflict. We also know that this is one of the key areas in which interventions can actually change relationship dynamics as part of violence prevention. And we know that poor mental health and substance abuse are inseparably linked to exposure to child abuse, and the lived reality of conflict within relationships, both in terms of women's mental health and likelihood of substance abuse being severely affected by their exposure to violence, as well as men's mental health and substance abuse being strongly linked to their chances of perpetration. So we see all of this, and underneath it, I've highlighted the conflict, post-conflict settings, because it's so important that we understand that the broader societal context of exposure to conflict critically influences experience of other forms of violence or perpetration. The next slide, please. So one of the key things that we looked at when we were reviewing the evidence that emerged from the program was the finding that some of the interventions that we implemented and that we evaluated showed strong evidence of reducing exposure to violence, particularly intimate partner violence, amongst the participants within the interventions. And some of them were much less successful in doing this. That wasn't unique for our work. And in fact, when we've completed the work research within the programme, we reviewed the field and were able to show that this was a strong feature of interventions within the field. We can't take it for granted that because interventions are implemented with the best intentions to prevent violence against women and girls, that they actually are effective in doing that. So one of the things we did was to try and drill down into not just the type of the intervention, but how it was designed, put together and implemented. And in fact, when we did this across the portfolio of What Works, we were able to see that there were key features of interventions. And normally we talk about 8 design features, just for the purposes of the slide, I've condensed 2 of them, and 2 features of implementation that critically influence whether interventions are successful. Now, some of the design features are important for every intervention designed, and some of them for the particular types. So every intervention needs to have a strong theory of change and to be tailored to local context. And what are the drivers of violence in the local context? They all need to tackle multiple drivers, particularly gender equality, but also other drivers that pertain within a local context, and these vary. Interventions are most effective when they include both men and women in the intervention. And when the design, if they're working for children, is an age-appropriate design. Participatory approaches are absolutely critical for interventions that are working with individuals, and within that, having critical reflection as an element within the participatory learning approaches is absolutely essential. It's very important that support for survivors is integrated into the interventions, and we don't see this as an alternative. We either support survivors or we prevent violence. We mustn't think in those ways anymore, and it's essential that we both support all of our survivors, participants within our intervention, but also send a strong message that we believe that violence against women is completely unacceptable, and our support and efforts are on focused on supporting survivors, much as we're interested in prevention and also working with people who perpetrate violence. It's essential that materials are well worked up and we have user-friendly manuals and materials when we implement. And it's essential that our interventions combine focuses on gender and where this fits, social empowerment, and focus on building collective change and fostering positive interpersonal relations. And then on the intervention implementation side, interventions must be of optimal intensity. They have to be long enough. There has to be enough intervention for people to change, but they shouldn't be like ridiculously long. And we have to have well-trained and supported facilitators. And so I think these are really critical learnings and very important for intervention design as we go forward into the next generation of interventions. Next slide, please. Of course, What Works did show us what we learned about what does work from both the series of interventions that we evaluated, as well as the field overall. And we did a summary overall. Fantastic that our finding was that at the end of 2018, already 95 different interventions had been rigorously evaluated to see if they did achieve an impact on an outcome that was a direct behavioral violence outcome. And that's so critically important, well past the stage of thinking about impact and measuring impact only on risk factors. It's essential that we look at impact on outcomes. When we reviewed the field, we found evidence that supported the essentially the elements of the RESPECT framework, which was drawn up and developed in very close consultation with the emerging findings from What Works. And essentially research, RESPECT shows us what we need to do in order to prevent violence. So we need to implement interventions to strengthen relationship skills. Stepping stones is an example of an intervention that does that. and couples interventions are doing this with great effect in the low and middle income countries where they're being used. We need to empower women, absolutely critical throughout our interventions. We need to ensure there are services for women experiencing violence and children if they're part of the intervention. We need to, where appropriate, have interventions that reduce poverty. There's now very good evidence of a range of different interventions that impact on poverty as a driver of violence, showing how well they work. We need to make our environment safe, and this is particularly important for elements of sexual violence prevention. We need to make sure that child and adolescent abuse is prevented. And obviously that doesn't always impact the women who are experiencing IPV today, but we need to think about the intergenerational transit mission of violence. And we need to, sorry, I can't see my slide, remember what the T is. We need to ensure that the last element, the T here, that I can't see, is also addressed. Sorry, the next slide. So I think it's really important that we, when we look overall and what we know, that we remember that violence against women and girls has a tremendous impact on the lives of women who are affected. It also influences families and economies and communities. We know it's preventable in programmatic timeframes. We don't want people anymore saying that we can't, it takes generations to stop violence. It doesn't. We can do it in a short term with the right intervention and the right backing behind the intervention. We have a repertoire of interventions that have been shown to do this, but we know that you have to design and implement interventions well or they don't work. And we're now positioned to make a real difference to women's lives. And our challenge is to go out there and do it. Can I have the next slide, please? As we do that, it's important to remember that there's only one intervention that's ever credibly changed claim to reduce violence against women and girls to zero. It's essential that we understand more about interventions and that we innovate, because there are huge gaps in the ability of the interventions we already have to be able to end violence against women and girls, which is obviously our goal. We know that still very few interventions have been taken to scale, and often there's a mismatch between those that have been evaluated and those scaled up. We sometimes see interventions without evidence scaled up. We need to bring these elements together. Knowledge on the long-term impacts of interventions is still very sketchy. We have some intervention evidence of intervention impact being sustained, but we want to know more about that. And we need to know more about how we integrate violence against women and girls into broader development programs. We need to end the clustering of knowledge and research and resources in high-income countries. And we need to challenge the funding gaps within the field, make sure that research that is done is priority driven and maps onto global priorities. Next slide, please. So the SVRI has made very important contributions to this work. And in the past year, it's done an analysis tracking research funding on violence against women and girls in low and middle income countries, and has shown that there still is so little money and so little of this, the resources available going into understanding what works, what doesn't work to prevent violence. The global research agenda has been developed by the SVRI, and this is an incredibly important guide for programming. Next slide. And it's incredibly important that we look at how to ethically conduct, implement, and fund research, and we integrate that into the work that we're doing. And so just some final reflections. I think it's incredibly important that we look at who and what gets funded and why, and we remember the vital importance of having local evidence and local people implementing, designing, researching interventions. Diversity and inclusion are critical here. We need to ensure that research funded is informed by the evidence base, that it's ethically sound, that it's feminist, and includes leadership by local research teams. And then we must celebrate the progress that we have been making. We've made tremendous progress over the last three decades when we've been concertedly working to advance the research agenda on to end violence against women, particularly in low and middle income countries. And it's important that we celebrate this, and it's important that we remember the need for self-care for everybody within the field. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rachel. It's always so refreshing to hear you and share such thoughtful insights and based on such a wealth of experience from the global level. Now we are going to hear from our very own Executive Director, Liz Dagnall, on the objectives, the history of this we are grant making, our approach to grant making too. Liz is a health specialist with over 20 years research and policymaking experience on health systems, mental health, violence against women, and violence against children. Having worked in several countries in both government and research positions, Liz has a deep understanding of the policy process and the use of research to inform policy and practice. Since 2006, Liz has managed the Sexual Violence Research Initiative, and in 2018, with the support of multiple partners, successfully launched the SVRI as an independent NGO. Over to you, Liz.
Thank you so much, Angelica, and thank you, Rachel, for such a wonderful overview of the field and where we're at, highlighting both the progress that we've made and the gaps in the field. I just want to apologize for our slides. I'm not quite sure we have why we've got these bars, but we're really not trying to hide anything from you. We'll share the slide deck after the event. And Rachel, it's really wonderful to know where we're at regarding the research. And today we're going to be announcing new research and research teams working to address these gaps, which is really exciting. But before the big reveal, a brief overview of our grant making and the progress over the years. Next slide, please. Morma. For those of you who don't know the SVRI, we have apparently almost 8,000 members now. We are the world's largest global network working to advance research on violence against women and violence against children in low and middle income countries. We were established in 2003 by a passionate group of researchers and practitioners, including Rachel. So it's so wonderful to have you on this call, Rachel, who recognized that there was a deep and continues to be a deep inequity in how research for violence against women is funded, and with most resources for research sitting in high-income countries with very limited research on violence against women and violence against children being done in low and middle income countries, led by researchers in low and middle income countries. And of course, this is completely unacceptable, and it's something that we are working to change. But whilst this issue does remain unsolved, I am optimistic that the things are improving, especially through efforts such as ours and the work of people like Rachel and many others in the field. And as Angelica highlighted, in 2019, the SVRI established ourselves as a feminist, women-led southern-based NGO, and we launched our new strategy, which on the screen highlights that we work around four key areas of building evidence, strengthening capacity, and promoting partnerships and influencing change. Every 2 to 3 years, we host the SVRI Hope Forum, and we hope all of you can join us in Cancun at the next forum in September, and Liesl will share the link in the chat for that. Thanks, Liesl. Next slide, please, Morma. So the SVRI has been grant making in many different ways since 2012, but in 2013, we formally launched the SVRI grant. And in 2015 to 2020, we created a pooled fund in partnership with the World Bank Group, our very wonderful partners in this process, where we co-funded together what we renamed the SVRI World Bank Group Development Marketplace Awards. And last year, we launched a new iteration of our grant making called the SVRI Research Grant, Knowledge to Action to End Violence Against Women and Violence Against Children in Low and Middle Income Countries. This is a pooled fund between the SVRI and an anonymous donor and CEDA. Many big thanks to our funding partner. Over this time, we have supported 69 grants up to $8.2 million US dollars, and today we're going to announce our new cohort. Next slide, please. In our grant making, we really work hard to ensure regional diversity is reflected in our grantee partners. And from this slide, you can see that within overall, over the past few many years that we've been grant making, 30% of our grants are awarded in Africa, just over 20% in Latin America and the Caribbean, 13% in Southeast Asia, 12% in Middle East and North Africa, and similar ratios across the other regions. And we really do continue to strive to ensure diversity and inclusion across all global regions. Next slide, please, Morma. The types of outputs produced by grantees, they're multiple and they're diverse, and they are for different types of audiences, because we care greatly about ensuring the research that we support does make an impact and does work to improve the lives of women and girls in low and middle income countries and children in their diversity, including girls and boys and adolescents. They've been posters, conference presentations, blog posts, briefing papers, project reports, peer reviewed journal articles, research reports and project videos. In 2014, SVRI, at SVRI Forum 2019 alone, 18 of our grantees presented their findings at the event. And just to let you know, the forum is an abstract driven event. It is difficult to get onto the program. It's peer reviewed, it's highly competitive. And so we're delighted at the excellence of the research that this grant making is producing, that it is able to get onto such a coveted event as the SVRI Forum. Next slide, please, Morma. We've recently conducted an external evaluation, and our grantees spoke about the impact of the grant on themselves personally and their work. But I have limited time, and so I'm going to let Anil, the Executive Director of Child SafeNet Nepal, who is speaking after me, to talk to this more from a personal perspective. But I really want to note that the SVRI provides a very non-traditional, kind of niche feminist way of funding. And the way that we fund is informed and firmly rooted in the recently published guidance on ethical funding for research on violence against women in low and middle income countries, which Rachel spoke about. I'd really like to thank all our grantee partners for their feedback on our work, confirming both that we are doing okay, but also providing us insights in how we can continue to strengthen our granting work and do it in a meaningful way that is making a huge difference and in a way that will make and continue to advance knowledge in the field. And we've already shared the link in the chat, but if you do review it or use it, we would love you to let us know how you found it and give us feedback on that. Thank you. Next slide, please, Morma. So for those of you who would like to partner with us on knowledge building in the future, here are some of the things that we really like to see in proposals. For us, it is essential and important that you demonstrate in your proposal how you have taken a deep dive into existing research, that your work is guided by the Global Shared Research Agenda and really does address a gap in the field, and that the research that you want to undertake will advance knowledge on violence against women and violence against children prevention and response in low and middle income countries and serve to improve policy and practice. We really care about the so what of your research question. Applications from local organizations based in low and middle income countries is really important as well, and increasingly more so. So really do think about the partnerships and who are the lead applicants in your proposals. Really important to us are applications from multidisciplinary, multi-sectoral consortiums. We recognize that this complex problem cannot be solved by one sector, one individual, one group alone. And so partnerships are really important. Please do show us how you have considered and are going to be addressing ethical issues. And also very importantly, how are you ensuring your findings will reach those who can use them to make a difference in the world of women and the world of children? Of course, clear budgets, logical budgets, sound budget justifications are super essential. And please spend some time on your abstract. It is a highly competitive funding grant. We would love lots of money and we'd love to be able to support everybody, but we get many proposals. Your abstract is such an important window into what you are wanting to do. And just know we do use it as an important tool in our shortlisting process. Once we do receive all the proposals, just to let you know, it is a very rigorous and transparent process. We will share the grant guidelines that outlines the process. There is a three-tier process with all the grants that we received are shortlisted. Then it goes to a second tier where they're shortlisted again, and then a final tier of an expert review panel that looks at all the shortlisted proposals and use clear criteria to assess this shortlist and make recommendations to the SVRI on what should be funded. So, you know, we really do have an incredible group of excellent grantees that we're going to be announcing later today. And also, just to let you know, we will be putting out a next call very soon. So please look out for that in the next upcoming SVRI updates. And for those of you who have not yet signed up to the update, Liesl will share the link with you in the chat. Thank you, Liesl. So back to you, Angelica.
Thanks so much, Lise. Always great to hear the history of the SVRI grant making program, which is fascinating to see how much we have progressed along the years. So now, like you mentioned, we want to hear from one of our current grantees. What has been the impact of receiving a grant from the SVRI? And I would like to introduce you to Anil Raghuvanshi from Nepal. ChildSafeNet is his organization. He's the ED of that organization. He's a seasoned child rights professional with more than 29 years of experience in the field of child protection at UN agencies and international organizations. He launched the Stop Think Connect movement in Nepal, and he was instrumental in starting the Safer Internet Day campaign in Nepal as well. We are very proud to count ChildSafeNet as one of the 2021 grantees, and Anil will share with you his experience so far. Welcome, Anil, over to you.
Thank you very much, Angelica. I'm honored and delighted to have this opportunity to share our thoughts. And thank you very much, SVRI, for this very important grant. Today, I would like to share some of the key impacts of receiving the SVRI grant. We are working on a research on online intimate partner violence against teens and young people in Nepal. Next slide, please. Thank you. Oh, I'm lucky here. Like, I don't see any black bars and boxes. The presentation is coming clearly. Thank you so much. So ChildSafeNet is a non-governmental organization based in Nepal. We are working to make the internet safer for children and young people and protecting children and young people in the digital age. Next slide, please. And the background of this research, the relevance is like the internet use is growing every day in Nepal. And so is the online sexual gender-based violence against teens and young people. But online IPV is not recognized as a serious issue in Nepal, mainly because there is no knowledge base. And the existing research studies conducted in Nepal on IPV focus only on primarily on the married couples and only on the offline dimensions of the IPV. Next slide, please. Now I would like to talk about the key impacts. The main impact here we are seeing is on the capacity building aspect. We have been receiving technical support from SVRI and its partners on the methodology and on use of the tools. Actually, we had capacity building workshops last year for 5 weeks. Online sessions were conducted because of the COVID situation, but it was a very good experience for us to learn about the ethical issues, about the dilemma, about the sensitivity on the research on sexual and gender-based violence. And we also got opportunity to network with the global experts, with academicians, with the practitioners, with the researchers. And we got a lot of insights and support from them. And if we need any help from them, SVRI kindly supported us and liaised with us to use the online survey tool or to use the ethical guideline. Those type of support are very crucial, and we are receiving the support from SVRI and its partners and network. And the other thing which is allowing us to develop our capacity is on developing a training module. To conduct the study, we have developed a training module which has different aspects of conducting research, the guidance, and also the skills and knowledge required for the research team. So the information and the resource from the training module can be used not only for this current research, but also for other research studies in future by Child SafeNet or by any organization. So the resources will be made available for everyone interested and everyone conducting research studies. Then we also develop resources like ethical considerations, data collection guides, data storage protocol, etc. So these are also very much valuable, and we are using, and we will continue to use these resources for our future research projects. And most importantly, this research also has a component of building an artificial intelligence tool to detect and prevent online intimate partner violence. This tool can be used not only for this research, but after the research, also to detect online IPV and other forms of gender-based and sexual violence against children and young people. And lastly, for the capacity building, we have now a very strong pool of resources. Very much they are working every day, and they are very much qualified to do such research. And also, they will learn more when they go to the field and do other things related to the research. So we are developing a pool of resources which will also be available to conduct similar researches in future. Next slide, please. The other important aspect of the impact is the greater awareness on online IPV. We expect with our uptake will be quite interesting. Particularly, we will be sharing our findings, the resources with our key stakeholders, which will help to conduct advocacy activities with the policymakers, and will impart focused knowledge and skills on online safety, along with the importance of support system to combat online IPV. And also, we will be using the knowledge through different uptake activities like video film, blogs, social media posts, so, and also the roundtable. So that will help us for the policy advocacy. And the policy advocacy will be to lobby for effective response mechanisms by the duty bearers and the stakeholders to remind them of their responsibilities to tackle online intimate partner violence. And lastly, to generate support from stakeholders to address the impact of online IPV. So we discuss with different international and national organizations, UN agencies. They are very much interested to continue their work, and they think this study will help them to improve their program planning, and they are willing to provide support. Like just yesterday, I had a meeting with UNICEF in Nepal. They are very much interested to know more about this research, and they will be linking the findings and the outcome of this research with their ongoing program. And also, they are planning to use the findings for development of their country program. So that's why I think we are very much happy to share good news. And also, we discuss with the government, with the ministry, with the National Child Rights Council. They all are very happy, and we are trying to get accreditation from the National Child Rights Council. And some government ministries, they are showing interest to collaborate with us to co-author the research. That's why the awareness, policy advocacy, and also to make this as a recognized and also established issue, and also to make the importance visible is also another impact of this research grant. And I think now I will be going to the next. Next is, I think that this is the end. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. If you have any questions or anything, please write to us at this email address and find more from our website. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Anil. Fantastic to hear, of course, the progress and also the kind words about how we have been able to assist you in the country with the research grant. But looking forward to hear more about the results of the research in the forum. And now, of course, the big moment of the event. But first of all, I want to emphasize the extremely competitive nature of the grant. We received 349 applications from all over the world this year. And actually, every year we get more and more applications. So it's very difficult actually to choose. And it's a very thorough process, as Liz already indicated. We have a panel of experts who recommend grants. So it's it gives me an enormous pleasure to introduce you to the winners of the SVRI 2022 research grant. The mystery ends here. And I want to start at home. And the first award goes to the Population Council in Ethiopia with a study titled Building Local Strategies to Reduce Broker Trafficking and Sexual Abuse of Migrant Girls in Ethiopia. Congratulations to the team and the PI, Annabel Erulkar, who will tell us about the setting of this research and the research consortium. Welcome, Annabel.
Thank you so much. So at the Population Council, we're extremely honored to be the recipient of an SVRI award, and this will enable us to further understand girls' migration experience in Ethiopia. As you might know, Ethiopia has one of the highest rates of rural urban migration in sub-Saharan Africa. But in fact, chief among the people who migrate from rural to urban areas are adolescent girls and adult women and young women. Typically, these young women make the migration from rural to urban areas on their own or with a friend, but they're often armed with very little information or understanding of what the urban environment holds for them. Upon arrival, they will often encounter a job placement broker or a labor intermediary who will help to place them in some kind of job, often a low status form of work, such as child domestic work or positions as barmaids or waitresses or in cafe workers. And sometimes they'll be trafficked into sex work or commercial sexual exploitation, and at times they are sexually abused in the process. So we're very pleased to have the opportunity to further the understanding of job placement brokers and their role and impact on girls' risk and well-being trajectory during the migration experience. For this research, Population Council will partner with the Organization for Prevention, Rehabilitation, and Integration of Female Street Children, which is also known as OPRIF. And OPRIF is a local NGO in Ethiopia with extensive experience in working with migrant girl populations. In fact, in the past, Population Council has partnered with OPRIF on several occasions, particularly in work on child domestic workers. So thank you once again to SVRI for this important opportunity to expand our understanding of girls' migration and to enable further support to girls who do make the migration from rural to urban areas. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Annabel. All the best with the research. And staying in Africa, our second winner is from South Africa. And the study's title, Childhood Trajectories of Violence and Adult Intimate Partner Violence, a Gender Life Course Approach to Violence Prevention. The research institution awarded the grant is the DSI NRF, Center of Excellence in Human Development at the University of the Witwatersrand. And we have here today the co-PI, Sarah Nyker, who could tell us about the context where the project will take place. Congratulations, Sarah, over to you.
Thank you very much, Angelica. Hi, everyone. I'm Sarah Nyker. I'm with the Center of Excellence in Human Development at the University of the Witwatersrand in South Africa. And together with my colleague Juliana Kagura at the university and our partners from the Violence Prevention Forum, we're working on analysis of primary and secondary data from a longitudinal South African birth cohort. The cohort is the longest and largest running cohort in Africa. The Center of Excellence is the first social science center funded by our government in South Africa, and we focus on human development. One of our six themes is violence, and we look at it through a life course transformational approach. We've got a multidisciplinary team working on this grant and an amazing partner, the Forum, which is led by the Institute for Security Studies. It's multisectorial and it's a platform that promotes the use of evidence in violence prevention in South Africa. And it's already had really good impact nationally and locally, strengthening relationships between researchers, government, NGOs, and development partners. But despite all of these wonderful things that we have, we are plagued in South Africa with pervasive violence. Prevalence rates of violence against children and violence against women are both high, and we're acutely aware of how the two intersect and that they're intergenerational. And apart from the serious documented individual trauma and impacts on health and well-being, the economic impact and social burden is equally high. Rachel alluded to the global impact earlier on, but specifically for South Africa, the cost is estimated at about 1% of our GDP for inaction against preventing violence against women and 5% of our GDP for children. We hope that our work will help to bridge the research, implementation, and policymaking fields so that we can really inform effective interventions in South Africa. And we're really grateful to be part of this group. We're excited to be working with the SVRI. We really appreciate having a locally based, entrenched organization to work with that understands the resource constraints that we face in implementation in South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. That's great. And looking forward to see the results of this very interesting research. I think we have all been looking forward to understanding more about these intersections. Now moving to Asia, it is a great pleasure to announce our third winner, Shanti Margam from Sri Lanka. They will implement a study called Creating a Digital Safe Space for Adolescents to Break Cycles of Violence Against Children and Violence Against Women in Sri Lanka. Congratulations and welcome to Batsala Ilesinge, founding member of Shanti Margam and co-PI in the study. Tell us a bit about the challenges of young people in Sri Lanka.
Thank you, Angelica. It's an absolute honor to be here as one of the SVRI grantees this year. And I'm really proud to represent my team of co-PIs and our non-for-profit in Sri Lanka called Shanti Margam, which translates to Pathways to Peace. I also want to introduce our executive director and PI on this project, Kamini, who's also here. Say hi, Kamini. Although I have taken the technical lead and put ideas on paper, none of this is possible without the commitment of a dedicated team of directors, staff, and volunteers at Shanti Margam. We're a relatively young community organization, and we've created a safe space for both physically and online during the pandemic for some of the most marginalized low-income communities in the capital of Sri Lanka, Colombo. And this project builds on our long-term feminist work on violence against women and children, and it addresses the multiple drivers that Rachel talked about today at the intersection of violence against women and children, promoting childhood emotional resilience and well-being. There are really two arms of our work. The first is community outreach, working with youth at the center. We adapt evidence-based interventions to the Sri Lankan context. To increase resiliency and address harmful gender attitudes. The second arm is offering free mental health services to youth, guided by leading mental health experts in Sri Lanka in local languages. And in this project, we are combining what we've learned through the pandemic into a safe digital application. When we jumped on board, to begin Shanti Margam about 6 years ago, we really didn't know how we are going to sustain this work or where it's going to take us and where we're going to get the funding for the next stages. So at the time, we would not have imagined being here or being widely recognized as a community mental health service provider for adolescents and youth, and how relevant our work would be during the pandemic and afterwards. This award is also testament to the skills that we bring together, a team of co-PIs on this project who have excelled in diverse fields from social work to adolescent psychiatry to digital innovation. And they sort of share a strong commitment to doing the work that matters most in Sri Lanka. We are really grateful for this huge support and to take the next step with SVRI, because it is recognizing the on-the-ground difficult work that happens in addressing violence against women and children. We are truly excited for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, and really looking forward to working with you in this project. And now, staying in Asia, our next winner is the University of Texas at Austin with a project that will test a domestic violence enhanced perinatal care intervention in China. The PI Yang Li will tell us now about the context for this research and about the local university partners. Welcome, Yang.
Thank you so much. We are so honored to receive this grant. First, I want to introduce our team. My name is Yang. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Texas Austin School of Nursing. Today, I speak on behalf of our team. My collaborators in China are Dr. Feng Lin Chao and Dr. Xue Kun Zhang. Dr. Chao is a professor at the Shandong University School of Nursing and Rehabilitation. Dr. Zhang is a faculty at the Shuzhou University School of Nursing. And we have two study sites. So we will work with health professionals at two perinatal clinics in Weihai and Shuzhou to conduct our project. Specifically, we will test the feasibility and acceptability of an empowerment-based IPV intervention in perinatal care with the aim of reducing violence against women and its impact on maternal and child health. Because intimate partner violence has been overlooked and a low priority in China, there are no interventions in China to help pregnant women deal with intimate partner violence. So our intervention will be the first structured IPV intervention integrated into perinatal care in China to help prevent maternal IPV and reduce its effects on maternal and child health. So we are really grateful for this offer of funding. We deeply appreciate the support from the SVRI. The grant from the SVRI will be very helpful for us to have our project move forward and reach our current goals. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Yang. Also looking forward to see what's going to be the result of your research. And now our fifth award goes to the Eastern Central Europe region. Congratulations to Sholpan Primbetova from the Social Fund Center for Scientific and Practical Initiatives in Kazakhstan. So they will implement a study aimed at improving access of women from marginalized populations to mainstream GBV services. Tell us a bit about the situation in Kazakhstan, Sholpan, and congratulations again.
Thank you very much, and hello, dear partners. We are very delighted and honored to join SVRI for implementing this very important project in Kazakhstan, because gender-based violence remains a serious public health threat in Kazakhstan and other countries of Central Asia. The rates of IPV and other forms of gender-based violence in Central Asia, unfortunately, are much higher and more severe among marginalized groups of women, including women who use drugs, women women who engage in sex work, women living with HIV/AIDS, as well as transgender women. And now it's migrant women who might come from Ukraine because of war with Russia. And this marginalized group of women in Central Asia and Kazakhstan are often excluded from the domestic violence services and are unable to access emergency shelters or legal protection to prevent their violence. For this project, we will be implementing an integrated gender-based violence response program to address service gaps for these most at-risk groups of women. We will provide the proof of concept of innovative evidence-based intervention called Women Initiating New Goals for Safety in combination with the coordinated community-based approach. The new intervention is the community that carries into the mainstream gender-based violence facilities in Kazakhstan. And these evidence-based interventions have been used to reduce violence and substance misuse in countries like United States, Kyrgyzstan, India, and Ukraine, and been implemented very successfully. We will adopt a computerized and self-paced version of this WINSC program to be delivered by social workers or case managers at NGOs or shelters. The project will partner with domestic violence crisis shelters in Almaty, which is one of the biggest cosmopolitan cities in Kazakhstan, and with local NGOs that will provide harm reduction services to women. Additionally, we will form the Community Action Community Advisory Board that will be comprised of the key stakeholders from the community. This is a very important project, right in time, and thank you very much, SVRI, for supporting it. And good luck to all partners.
Thank you so much, Alfan, and it's very important you reminded us of the need of this type of work now that we are in a current situation with the war in your region. Thank you so much for reminding us of that. So now we are going to move to Latin America. And congratulations, felicitaciones al Instituto de Salud Pública de México, Public Health Institute of Mexico, and partners, and the PI Leonor Rivera Rivera. They will implement a study titled Application of Artificial Intelligence in the Prevention of Child Sexual Abuse in Mexico, Pinta tu Raya Así. Leonor, tell us about why this is such an important project in Mexico, where we have, we know we have high levels of violence against women and violence against children. Leonor, you're in mute.
Thank you, Angelica. I am Leonor Rivera Rivera. I work at the National Institute of Public Health in Mexico. We are an academic institution committed to the Mexican population that conducts research on relevant public health problems, including the problem of gender violence. She's Aremis.
Hi. Hi, nice to meet you. My name is Aremis. I am the director of our reproductive health division at the Center of Population and Health Research at the National Institute of Public Health. In this division, we have participated in different sexual and reproductive health research related with digital tools. Some of them were formed by the National Institute of Women as a massive course directed to health providers in order to prevent adolescent pregnancy. And we have a web page for adolescent population. In this site, we aim to increase the knowledge, cell efficacy, and skills for adolescents concerning the exercise of a healthy sexuality and prevention of pregnancy prevention. And with the National Center for Technological Research and Development, CENIDET, we are working in digital violence. And for this specific project, we working together with research of CENIDET and with professionals from society, civil society organization. We are really happy to be here with you, and we are sure with this new project will be a wonderful experience for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Muchas gracias, Leonor. Muchas gracias al equipo de México. And last but not least, ending our tour of the world, we are going to the MENA region. And it is an absolute pleasure to introduce the last award to the Social and Economic Policies Monitor based in Palestine with a project titled Hemaya Protection, Protecting Women and Girls with Disabilities from Violence in Palestine. Firas Jaber, the PI, is with us today, and he will tell us a bit about the context of the partnership also with the Stars of Hope Society. Thank you, Firas, over to you. Firas, you are in mute.
Thank you, Angelica, for the presentation of the project. We are building our project based on three main elements. One of them is the colonial occupation in Palestine, and the second one is the structural violence, and the third one is the community violence, basically. We are trying to analyze and to see the implications of those three elements on the violence against women with disabilities and the service provision made to them. Basically, the occupation has raised the disability percentage in Palestine up to 7% of the people, and many wars against the Palestinian people, especially in Gaza Strip, has made thousands of our young men and women disabled, basically. For only 4% of women with disability participating in the labor sector, which leaves them fragile and exposed to violence. The National Violence Survey in 2019 has shown us that 37% of women with disabilities who are currently or previously married has been subject to violence by their spouses at least once during the last 12 months. Basically, in Palestine, women with disabilities are neglected and excluded to a great extent from the state and non-state anti-VAW programs, including prevention and response. For this purpose, we have built this project to respond to the two main things. One is the national referral system, and the second is the safe houses or shelters, to see how to integrate the requirements of the women with disabilities in those two policies, and to provide protection for women with disabilities. Thank you again for the presentation, and hope to see you later.
Thank you so much, Firasan. So, really, congratulations again to everyone, to all our new awardees and grantees, and we look forward to working with you this year. But for the audience, we have prepared a short video where you can see more about the context, to not just hear from the researchers, but also to see a bit where will this research take place. So, a short video right now.
The Sexual Violence Research Initiative, with over 7,500 members, is the largest global network working to build knowledge for improved practices and the prevention of violence against women and violence against children in low and middle-income countries. The SVRI is unapologetically committed to addressing inequities in research funding and priority setting between high-income countries and low- and middle-income countries. One way we do this is through the SVRI grant, Knowledge for Action to End Violence Against Women and Violence Against Children, a grant-making program generously supported by the Swedish International Development Corporation Agency and Wellspring Philanthropic Fund. We are therefore very proud to share with you the winners of the SVRI Research Grant for 2022. Please meet our 2022 grantees.
My name is Yang Li. I work at the University of Texas at Austin School of Nursing. My collaborators work at the Shandong University and the Shuzhou University in China.
My name is Annabelle Irokar, and I work at the Population Council's office in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia.
My name is Asel Terlikbaeva, and I am the director for the Public Foundation Center for Scientific and Practical Initiatives based in Almaty, Kazakhstan.
Mi nombre es Leonor Rivera Rivera. Soy investigadora en ciencias médicas en la Dirección de Salud Sexual y Reproductiva del Instituto Nacional de Salud Pública. Estamos ubicados en la ciudad de Cuernavaca, Morelos, México.
اسمي فراس جابر وانا باحث. مقر عملنا هو مدينة رام الله في فلسطين المحتلة. اعمل في مرصد السياسات الاجتماعية والاقتصادية.
My name is Sarah Naika. I work at the Center for Excellence in Human Development at the University of Witwatersrand. I am based in South Africa.
My name is Vatsala Ilesinga. I'm one of the founding directors of Shanti Marka, a community-based not-for-profit in Sri Lanka.
Our project is called Improving the Access of Women from Marginalized Groups to a Mainstream Gender-Based Violence Services in Kazakhstan. Our research is important because the rates of violence in marginalized groups of women have been found much higher in Kazakhstan. However, these groups of women are often denied access to mainstream shelters and legal protection.
The title of the research project is Testing the Domestic Violence Enhanced Perinatal Care in China. Our research is trying to integrate structured intimate partner violence intervention into perinatal care in China. Our study is important because intimate partner violence is prevalent during pregnancy and in the postpartum period. But intimate partner violence has been overlooked and a low priority in China.
احنا بنعمل على مشروع اسمه مشروع حمايه لحمايه النساء ذوات الاعاقه من العنف في فلسطين. الدراسه مهمه لان هناك اقصاء وتمييز للنساء ذوات الاعاقه وبالاجمال تغيب السياسات الوطنيه ما فيها تلك المتعلقه بالعنف النساء ذوات الاعاقه من نصوصها ومن برامجها وخدماتها. لذلك نحاول إدماج ودمج النساء ذوات الإعاقة في هذه السياسات وفي كافة الخدمات المقدمة للوقاية والحماية من العنف.
The research question we're trying to answer is, what do trajectories of violence in childhood look like and how do they relate to intimate partner violence outcomes later in life? Our study is important because we use longitudinal data to build an understanding of the risk and protective factors that might push or pull individuals away or towards violent outcomes across their life course.
Our research is entitled Local Strategies to Reduce Broker Trafficking and Sexual Abuse of Migrant Girls in Ethiopia. So when girls and young women migrate into the city, often one of the first people that they will encounter upon arrival is a job placement broker. Little is known about these interactions between newly arriving girls and job placement brokers, but the evidence that we have so far is that they can be both a source of risk as well as at times protective of girls.
The question this research is trying to address is how can we adapt our existing safe space for youth into a digital application in order to promote positive mental health, gender equitable attitudes for the prevention of violence against women and children in the long term. This work is important because it is at the intersection of mental health and violence against women and children.
Con nuestro proyecto buscaremos responder la siguiente pregunta de investigación. Al implementar en las escuelas un modelo de intervención psicopedagógica utilizando la inteligencia artificial, ¿aumentará el conocimiento y las habilidades en las niñas y niños para prevención del abuso sexual? Nuestro estudio de investigación es importante debido a que en México la incidencia de abuso sexual infantil ha incrementado de manera acelerada. Desafortunadamente, las niñas y los niños, sobre todo en las zonas desprotegidas del país, no cuentan con suficiente información que fomente el autocuidado y la autoconfianza que coadyuven en la prevención del abuso sexual infantil.
Our study will advance the field by culturally tailoring and testing to evidence-based interventions, but also will bring significant changes to health and lives of women from vulnerable groups.
Our research will advance the field and improve the lives of women and children by integrating a structured intimate partner violence intervention into perinatal care in China.
نستخدم البحوث إجمالا كرافعة في مجال المناصرة التأثير على صناع القرار وتطوير السياسة ويشمل تحديدا مسألة وقائعهم من العنف و
Our research will help advance the field and improve the lives of women and children. When we understand who is most at risk for persistent violence across the life course, we have a better understanding of who is most vulnerable earlier. All of this evidence together gives us a better, more effective approach at preventing gender-based violence.
So this research is both expanding our knowledge about the role of job placement brokers, as well as exploring potential solutions to making that migrant transition safer for newly arriving girls.
We will work with youth to create an application that's attractive to them, with features to monitor progress towards milestones and to ask for help and receive it quickly when they need it most.
A través de este proyecto avanzaremos en términos de política pública al adoptar en las escuelas este modelo de prevención de abuso sexual infantil y de esta manera mejorar la calidad de vida de niñas y niños de México.
La iniciativa de investigación de violencia sexual ha proporcionado hasta la fecha más de 8 millones de dólares estadounidenses, 75 proyectos de investigación en 40 países de ingresos bajos y medios en todo el mundo. Este nuevo cohorte de investigadoras e investigadores conducirán estudios éticos guiados por las necesidades de sobrevivientes y por principios feministas. Los resultados de sus investigaciones, aparte de incrementar nuestros conocimientos en el campo a nivel global, serán compartidos ampliamente en sus comunidades y con encargados y encargadas de políticas a nivel gubernamental. Por sobre todo, estos estudios están orientados a apoyar cambios concretos en las vidas de mujeres, jóvenes, niños y niñas afectados por la violencia de género en todo el mundo. Thanks so much, everyone. So we are coming to an end of our webinar. I hope you enjoyed the video. The video will be available in the website of the SVRI with the subheadings and translation. Apologies for something went wrong today with the Zoom and that bar, you know, the gremlins today were at work. But I do hope you enjoy the webinar. I do hope you enjoy listening to our grantees. Welcome again to everyone. Congratulations. So much looking forward to meeting you in person one of these days and working with you in the next 2 years. And now I'm going to hand over to Rachel, who is going to close the webinar.
Well, thank you very much, everybody. And this has been a fabulous webinar. It's been so interesting getting to know a bit about all of the new projects and meet all of the grantees. And I'm sorry about that we couldn't see the English translation throughout the video, but I look forward to being able to see it again. And I'm sure that we'll see it again. So I want to thank you very much, everybody who's presented. for sharing your plans for your research with us. And we really look forward to following this over the next couple of years as you conduct and finalise and generate your new learnings from the research. And of course, I want to thank all the reviewers, because this whole process is based on tremendous number of submissions with a tremendous number of people giving their time voluntarily to review everything. And so thank you very much to everybody who was involved in the review and the selection process. And thank you very much, Anil, for coming back and sharing your findings from your grant and the great work that you've been doing in Nepal. So I want to just end by thanking everybody in the wonderful SVRI team, and Angelica, particularly yourself, for organising, pulling together this great webinar today. Thank you to Morma for producing the webinar. And thank you for Liz for being a wonderful leader of the SVRI, without which there would not be the 8,000 members that we're so pleased to have today. And we really hope that we will see a lot of our 8,000 members in Cancun later on in the year. And thanks very much to everybody within the SVRI for being such an awesome team and bringing this tremendous knowledge hub to our field to empower us all in our work. So thank you very much, everybody. And I wish you a good night or a good day. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rachel. Good night or good morning, everyone. And we'll be in touch. Bye.
Good luck. Take care. Bye.
Bye.